In this portion of human geography, we are going to start with the human geography in India. All right. So first thing is, what is human geography? हाँ भाई, पता है किसी को? How do you define human geography, or what do you make out of the two words, human geography? That is more like population study and census. What does it have to do with geography? Okay, you are somewhat close. Human resources related to geography of India. Yes, Sarthak, I have started. Anybody else wants to try? What do you understand by human geography? Human activities relation with their environment. Okay, very close. See, do you feel that geography affects you in a certain way? Do you feel that geography will affect where you live, where population density is high, where certain industries are set up? Do you think it will affect? It will, right? People would like to live in more moderate kind of climates, no? Nobody wants to live in the Arctic or the Antarctic. Where do people want to live? They want to live in the Mediterranean, tropical regions. Right? In India, nobody wants to live in the Western Rajasthan. Nobody wants to live in Barmer or Jaisalmer. Right? Where do people want to live? People want to live in Pune, Bombay. Why? The weather is moderate. All right. Most of your cotton industry, where is it located? It is located in Gujarat. It is located in Mumbai. Why? Because cotton production is happening here. If you put the industry elsewhere, your transportation cost of raw material will increase. So geography will affect your economy. It will affect your population distribution. It will affect your population composition, migration of population, the kind of economical setup that you have. Will it be primary, secondary, tertiary? All of that is somewhat related to geography. Even your international relations are related to geography to one extent. Okay. Why is it that US is always helping Pakistan? Why is it that they give them F-16 fighters? We are also friends with US. Hame kyun nahi dete jets? F-16 diya hai na? Tumne padha hi hoga news jab wo wing commander Abhinandan wali news aayi hogi. So you might have read, right, that US gave Pakistan F-16 jets, which they used in that. So why is it that they give it to them and not to us? We are also friends, so we gave them hydroxychloroquine also. Then why not us? सोचो, आंसर दो कुछ. थिंक द आंसर इज सिंपल. इट इज इन ज्योग्राफी ऑफ पाकिस्तान. बिकॉज यूएस इज इंटरेस्ट lies in the regions of Afghanistan, Iran, Iraq. Right? These are the countries of interest for USA. Who shares borders with them? India or Pakistan? Pakistan. So geographically, Pakistan will always be a better friend. If they want to keep a check on Afghanistan, if they want to keep a check on Iran, Pakistan is geographically a better option. Understood? Abhi samajh mein aaya how it affects international relations. So, geography will affect almost every aspect of your life. Why is it that you have so much of mining in industry developed in Rajasthan or in the Chota Nagpur Plateau? Because minerals hai hi wahi pe. So obviously वहाँ पे mining industry होगी तो वहाँ पे mining type का labour work तुमको मिलेगा, तुमको mostly primary sector में काम करने वाली labour मिलेगी. Make sense, right? So that is why we have this subject of human geography so that we can understand this aspect. All right. So in this book, it is class 12th NCERT. It's called India, People and Economy. All right. It is called India, People and Economy. It's a class 12th NCERT. It's a new NCERT. All right. Why I am saying new NCERT? Because human geography will have a lot of data. So new NCERT will always have an updated data. All right. So for human geography, always and always follow the new NCERT or the latest books. Okay. Now you know that in 2021, we are due for another census. Population census hota hai na har 10 saal mein. To 11 mein hua tha, ab 2021 mein hoga agla. All right. So that is when these books will be updated again. So make sure that you always follow the new NCERT, the latest NCERT for human geography. All right. So now the first chapter that I'm going to start with is population in India. That is the distribution, the density of population, the growth of population and composition of the population. All right. So, you know, India is the second most populous country in the world after China. All right. Now, this is an old book. 2001 data says that we have 1,028 million people. But now, you know, we have around 125 to 130 billion people in India. All right. Sorry, 1.25 billion people in India. 125 to 130 crore people are there in India as of now. All right. No, Sarthak, India, People and Economy does not have two parts. There are two books for the subject of human geography. One is India, People and Economy, and second one is Fundamentals of Human Geography. India, People and Economy is only one part. Okay? Similarly, for Physical Geography, again, you will have two books. Fundamentals of Physical Geography and India Physical Environment. Okay. So right now we are doing India People and Economy. Okay. So now we are going to discuss distribution, density and growth and composition. So first is distribution of population. So now first you tell me, see, this is a very, human geography is a very general subject in which even you can all participate. All right. So now you tell me, ki India mein kaun si aisi jagah hai jahan pe tumko lagta hai ki population ki distribution zyada hai ya kam hai? You know, what do you think? Where is population high? Where is low? And what are the reasons for it? Coastal areas will have a higher population. Why? Population is less dense in Northeast. What do you think? What are the geographical factors behind this? See, even if you see so geographically, the area, coastal areas, more availability of water. Dekho, for life to sustain, no, three things are important. Roti, kapda, makan. All right. Now, if you see the coastal areas, availability of water is good. So you have agriculture, which is good. You can grow paddy, you can grow other things. All right, flat surface, good monsoon, you can easily build houses. Hills mein ghar banana mushkil hai, coastal plains mein banana asaan. All right. If you have good economy, good agriculture, you will get good money. So you can have other things in life, other needs of your life. Plus, cotton industry, silk industry, ye sab kitna zyada hai wahan pe. So all your needs, from water to food to clothing to shelter, everything is fulfilled in these coastal areas. All right. Now, other than geographical factor, there are historical factors also. There are cultural factors also. All right. Based on which you will find cities. Now you see these port areas, Bombay, very well developed because it has been a port since the time of the British. Surat, well developed. It has been a port since the time of the Mughals. Historically, some cities are important. Delhi, Lahore, historically important. So always been good big cities. Some cities are cultural centers. Banaras, cultural center. Kedarnath, Badrinath, cultural centers. So cities have developed there, people have settled there. All right. So now in India, if you see factually, if you see the states like UP, Maharashtra, Bihar, West Bengal, Andhra Pradesh, these are the ones which have majority population in India. All right. Whereas you see other states, J&K ho gaya, Arunachal Pradesh, Uttarakhand, and like someone pointed out, Northeast has less people. Right. Because historically also, you see, who will go and settle in the jungles? Now, yes, the government has started a policy wherein, you know, they are making tribals a part of the whole, you know, development plan of the country. But pre-independence, who will go and settle there? It was only the tribals who were living there, they were living there. Or you see Rajasthan. Who will want to come and settle in Jaisalmer? Why would they want no availability of water? The climate is not suitable. Right. So since these things are not available, so obviously people will not settle. So such distribution, such variation in distribution, it is a result of a lot of socio-economic, physical, like geographical factors, socio-economic factors, and historical factors. All right. So when it comes to geographical factors, you see availability of natural resources. You can jot this down if you want. Geographical factors which affect distribution of population in India. Yes, correct. It will depend, Rajshree. Good point. It will depend on how far the government has implemented population control measures. Governance will also matter. It will matter. Yes, correct. Now jot this down. The physical factors which affect, or geographical factors which affect population distribution in India. First is availability of natural resources. Availability of natural resources. Such as minerals, such as minerals, fertile soil, availability of water resources, availability of irrigation facilities, second point, climate of the region, third is relief, what is relief in geography? What does the word relief mean in geography? Height, structure, not the words that I'm looking for. Slope, no. You're close, but you're not getting to the words that I'm looking for. See, relief means if an area, what kind of an area it is. Is it a plain? Is it a hilly area? Right, so the terrain. All right, what is the distance between the highest peak and the lowest point? Bahut upar khabad area hai, ye flat area hai, hills and valleys wala area hai, ya plains hai. That is relief. All right, so the terrain. All right. Okay, so now you tell me based on agricultural demand, soil fertility, irrigation, which are the regions which will have higher population? Everybody can participate in this. See, this is not, you know, something very difficult. It is very simple, very easy. You can think logically, bhi sochoge to iska answer aayega. Aisa human geography is very simple. All you need to do is apply logic. That's it. So northern plains, coastal plains, obviously availability for agriculture, agar aap dekho, so it is those regions which are thickly populated. All right. Deltas of various regions are populated. Okay, as compared to, you know, your Himalayan states, or as compared to your desert regions, or as compared to the regions of tribal regions wherein mostly forest hai, tum kaat ke agriculture nahi kar sakte ho. Yes, but now what is happening? That post-independence, humne bahut sare measures liye, humne transportation improve kiya. So now things are developing there. Right now in this region of Bikaner, Barmer, you have agriculture and people are growing paddy in this region. Bikaner, Barmer, kitni garmi hoti hai, barish nahi padti hai is tarah jagah mein, par log chawal ki kheti kar rahe hai. Kaise? What has led to that? Canal irrigation, you got the Indira Gandhi Canal project. Since then, there is good availability of water, ample availability. So now people have started settling here also. Yes, religious places, that is what I'm saying, ancient cultural centers are also important for deciding population density. That is when I gave the example of Banaras. Culturally important center hai. Right, Jagannath Puri, constant culturally important center. Puri in Odisha, culturally important center hai. All right, so yes, religion does play a role in population density. All right. So, if you see the socio-economic factors, then agriculture hai ki nahi hai, is transport available or not, is industrialization available or not, or urbanization hai ya nahi hai. Now, why are there so many people who are, you know, coming to Mumbai as migrants? Why does everybody, especially, you know, people are from the financial sector, they all want to come to Mumbai? Why? because it's the financial hub of the country. All right, so everybody wants to migrate to this region. Now, if so many people are migrating, you're going to need houses for them. So you're going to have to construct new houses. If you want to construct new houses, you will need labor. So a lot of people from rural area will also migrate to Mumbai. So these are the socio-economic factors. Abhi humne isse pehle kya dekhe physical factors. Socio-economic factors mein kya aayega? What is the kind of economy? Is there industrialization? Is there urbanization? Is there availability of transportation? Is it safe? Safety. Now, after 370 has been removed from Jammu and Kashmir, anybody can go and set up a business there? Can you do that now after 370 is repealed? How many people went and opened their business immediately? Nobody did. Did you see all of a sudden, no, Reliance has opened a big factory or Tata has opened a big factory? No, because safety factor is not there. Right? Similarly, you see other things. Women migration will not happen in certain areas. Why? Not safe for women. Right? You will say, okay, I will not send my daughter or my sister or my wife to work in that city because I feel it's not safe for women. Right? So those are, again, socioeconomic factors. Okay, then one major social factor for migration can be, which will affect, is marriage, especially in case of women. Zara, I won't name one city. There are many cities wherein you won't send a female, right? Because you feel that those cities are not secure. All right, like for example, post the Nirbhaya incident, a lot of people had the same apprehensions about Delhi also, that it's not safe for women. Right, so I won't name one city. There are multiple such cities. All right. Okay, so there are multiple such reasons. Like marriage is again a social factor. And then, as someone rightly pointed out, political factors. कई कई जगह पे गवर्नेंस पॉलिसीज और इंडस्ट्रियल पॉलिसीज इतनी अच्छी बनाई है सरकार ने दैट people want to come and set up industry in that state. All right, you see so many states are coming up. So Madhya Pradesh came up with this thing that you can come and make it in Madhya Pradesh and make an industry. We'll have a single window clearance. We'll provide you quick clearances so that you can immediately set up an industry. All right, in some places, the governance, the police system is so good, so efficient, that people want to come and settle there because of a better lifestyle, because of a safer lifestyle. So those political factors are also important. All right. So these are the various factors which will affect the density of distribution of which will affect the distribution of population in India. All right. Now coming to the data that you're going to need from this. See, 2011 census ke upar questions ab aayenge prelims mein. That is highly unlikely. All right. Yes. But those of you who aim to appear later, you know, 2021 or 2022, when the new census data will be updated. All right. 22 mein mostly jo log appear karenge. So those people have to be a little careful about the facts like which states have the highest population, which has the lowest population, which has the highest population density, which has the lowest population density, which states have shown an increase in population, which are there any states which have shown a decrease in population, distribution of minorities, right? So those people who are appearing post the census, they have to take care of these factors. Otherwise, in the prelims 2020, questions from population census of 2011 are highly unlikely. 2011 के सेंसस के सवाल नहीं आएंगे हाँ बट फॉर योर मेन्स आंसर्स यस यू मस्ट नो द बेसिक्स राइट यू मस्ट नो द फैक्टर्स बिकॉज यू कैन इनकॉर्पोरेट दीज इन योर मेन्स आंसर्स अंडरस्टूड इज इट क्लियर
All right.
We have a lot of new people in the class now, so आप लोगों को समझ में आ रहे हैं, those who have joined the class, since it's a fresh batch, so a lot of people have joined. So are you able to understand? Is there something that you don't understand? You tell me. All right, good. Now the next thing is, अभी तुमने डिस्कस जो है वो पॉपुलेशन ऐसे अरेंज होती है. ये फैक्टर्स है जो पॉपुलेशन डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन को अफेक्ट करते हैं, राइट? नाउ एवरी प्लेस विल हैव अ डिफरेंट पॉपुलेशन डेंसिटी, राइट? पॉपुलेशन डेंसिटी का क्या मतलब है कि 1 किलोमीटर स्क्वायर में कितने लोग रह रहे हैं. All right, how many people are staying in 1 किलोमीटर स्क्वायर एरिया? In India, 1 किलोमीटर स्क्वायर एरिया में कितने लोग रहते हैं? That is known as population density. Okay. So, which state do you think has the highest population density in India? देखो, पॉपुलेशन और पॉपुलेशन डेंसिटी दो अलग चीज है, ये चीज याद रखना. सी, अकॉर्डिंग टू द 2011 सेंसस, ऑल राइट, द हाईएस्ट पॉपुलेशन डेंसिटी इज इन बिहार. And after that, you have West Bengal, and then you have UP. All right, these are the figures according to the 2011 census. यूपी की पॉपुलेशन ज्यादा है, बट एरिया भी तो ज्यादा है, वो भी तो देखो ना. एक जगह है जहां पे 150 लोग रह रहे हैं पर 4 किलोमीटर स्क्वायर एरिया है. एक जगह है जहां पे 100 लोग रह रहे हैं पर 2 किलोमीटर स्क्वायर एरिया है. विच विल हैव अ हायर डेंसिटी? द सेकेंड वन, राइट? सो द सेम थिंग हैपेंस इन यूपी एंड बिहार. इफ यू कंपेयर द पॉपुलेशन, यूपी इज अ हायर नंबर, बट बिहार इज ऑब्वियसली स्मॉलर इन एरिया एज कंपेयर टू यूपी. सो द हायर पॉपुलेशन डेंसिटी इज इन बिहार. ऑल राइट, सो इफ यू कंपेयर इट टू अदर स्टेट्स, राइट, लाइक यू नो स्टेट्स इन द नॉर्थ ईस्ट, तो वहां पे बहुत कम है. यू कंपेयर इट टू राजस्थान, पॉपुलेशन डेंसिटी बहुत कम है. Now tell me, why in Bihar इतनी ज्यादा population कैसे है? Are there any resources in Bihar? है कुछ mineral resources? Agriculture is one factor. Mineral resources अब बिहार में ज्यादा नहीं है. जब से बिहार से एक स्टेट अलग हुई, बिहार से अलग हुई कौन सी स्टेट बनी है? बिहार से अलग, झारखंड, राइट? सो जब से बिहार से अलग हुई झारखंड बनी है, मोस्ट ऑफ द मिनरल रिसोर्सेज हैव गॉन टू झारखंड. ऑलराइट, सो मिनरल रिसोर्सेज आर नॉट देयर. सो अ कपल ऑफ फैक्टर्स आर इम्पोर्टेंट रीजंस व्हाई यू नो बिहार हैज अ हाई पॉपुलेशन डेंसिटी. इज फर्स्ट इज दैट एग्रीकल्चरली कुछ एरिया है बिहार में विच इज गुड. सेकेंड इज दैट देर आर सेंटर्स ऑफ विच हैव बीन यू नो एंशियंट सिटीज विच हैव बीन इम्पोर्टेंट, लाइक यू हैव पटना. ऑल राइट, देन द थर्ड थिंग इज हायर पॉपुलेशन बिकॉज ऑफ इलिटरेसी, राइट? फर्टिलिटी रेट बहुत ज्यादा है वहां पे, बच्चे बहुत पैदा कर रहे हैं वहां पे लोग. गवर्नेंस पॉलिसीज ऐसे नहीं है, इलिटरेसी ज्यादा नहीं है, सो पॉपुलेशन कंट्रोल पॉलिसी नहीं है. सो दैट इज अगेन अ रीजन दैट वहां पे बहुत ज्यादा फर्टिलिटी है. ऑल राइट, एंड एज अ रिजल्ट यू हैव अ हायर पॉपुलेशन डेंसिटी. ऑल राइट, कम टू राजस्थान, पॉपुलेशन डेंसिटी इज वेरी लो. व्हाई? देर इज नो अवेलेबिलिटी. वन बेसिक नीड इज वॉटर. तुम यहां राजस्थान में आओ, तुम देखो एक घर होगा, फिर 1 किलोमीटर छोड़ दो, फिर दूसरा घर होगा. राइट? वाई? इट्स अ डेजर्ट एरिया. उतनी, अरे जब 4 लोग रह रहे थे उनके लिए इनफ वाटर होना चाहिए ना, ग्राउंड वाटर. वो 1 किलोमीटर स्क्वायर में उतना ही ग्राउंड वाटर है जो 3 या 4 लोगों को ही सस्टेन कर सकता है. सो ऑब्वियसली दे आर नॉट एबल टू हैव दैट अवेलेबिलिटी ऑफ वाटर. सिमिलरली यू लुक एट एग्रीकल्चर, सॉइल इज नॉट फर्टाइल. Right, soil is really not fertile here. So in 1 kilometer square, you cannot grow paddy like Punjab and Haryana and Bihar. कि 1 kilometer square में तुम इतनी उगा दो कि भाई पूरे गांव को खिला दो. नहीं, यहाँ नहीं हो सकता. All right, ma'am, but can we directly link literacy and population density? I really don't think so. You can link them. You most definitely can link them, because a person who's literate. Alright, majority, yes. हाँ, अब फिर तुमको couple of examples you will find wherein you know literate people are also, you know, they have many children. But mostly literate people you will find that they have less children. Reason being, if you are literate, you will have a job. Alright, you will know the hardship that you face in raising one child and giving them a life. Alright, rather than you are an illiterate person, you are into primary sector, you feel more hands to work, the better it is, more income for the family. All right. So yes, it is quite related to each other. All right. Literacy also brings attention the sexual health and the science behind reproduction. So you also come to know about the contraceptives and those things, so you can also use those. That is why you see, why are the developed countries, why do they have less population? Why do they have a stable population? Literacy is a very big reason behind it. So, Baba, population density is also related to population growth only, no? अगर एक जगह पे ज्यादा बच्चे पर ईयर पैदा होंगे तो वहां पे पॉपुलेशन डेंसिटी भी तो बढ़ जाएगी. कैन यू लिंक दैट? राइट? सो लिटरेसी ब्रिंग्स इन मेनी फैक्टर्स. लैंड, हाँ एग्जैक्टली. अगर ऐसा थोड़ी कि आज 1 लाख बच्चे पैदा हुए तो लैंड भी बढ़ के एक्सपैंड हो जाएगी. करेक्ट. सो यस, लिटरेसी इज लिंक्ड टू पॉपुलेशन एज वेल एज पॉपुलेशन डेंसिटी. ऑलराइट, सो नाउ यू सी देर आर नो रिसोर्सेज इन राजस्थान, सो पॉपुलेशन डेंसिटी हियर इज वेरी लो. इनफैक्ट व्हेन यू ड्राइव थ्रू राजस्थान यू विल फाइंड दैट द स्टेट लैंग्वेज हियर इज हिंदी. ऑलराइट, सो इफ देर आर 10 to 12 houses in a region. All right, it is marked as high population density region. Ya Hindi mein likha hota hai ghani abadi kshetra. 10 to 12 houses. That is high population density for this region. Can you imagine that a place with just 10 to 12 houses in Mumbai? No. Why? Because the area can only support 10 to 12 people. उतने ही लोगों के लिए fertility है नहीं soil में, तो आप ज्यादा grain नहीं produce कर पाओगे. पानी नहीं है तो आप ज्यादा ग्राउंड वाटर एक्सट्रैक्ट नहीं कर पाओगे. रिसोर्सेज नहीं है तो आप ज्यादा रिसोर्सेज नहीं एक्सट्रैक्ट कर पाओगे. All right? So those are the various factors which affect, you know, the natural factors. Similarly, you see hill states, right? You have Himalayan region states. Again, low densities. You can't build, no, a 50-floor building in Shimla. Can you build on a hill? No. You can only do that in the plains. Now, Bombay has so many, you know, high-rise buildings, 60 floors, 50 floors. Right? Can you do that in Dharamshala or Srinagar? You can't. Because the geography won't allow you. So terrain is another factor which will affect density. So every factor which will affect population will also affect the density of population. All right. So if you see this map, high population density areas, ye hai, Delhi. Population density is so high. Okay, you see the region of Bihar, Jharkhand, Bihar, West Bengal. All right, see the region of UP. See the region of Kerala. High population density. Yes, we are going to be the world's most populated. At the rate at which we are rising, we definitely are going to be the world's most populated country. That is why, you know, your prime minister is telling people that even having limited number of children is an act of patriotism. Right, because you have to see that can you provide those, if you have children, can you provide them with good education, with good resources? All right. Why didn't we implement one child policy like China? I've been asked this question many times. Haan bhai, baaki logon ko kya lagta hai? Kyun China mein thi na one child policy? Ki ek hi bachcha paida karo, dusra paida karoge to sarkar le jayegi. Why do you think we did not implement it? Why do you think we did not implement it? See, because China is a communist nation without a true democracy and without any belief in human rights. इंडिया में ऐसा नहीं है. All right. So that India, in India, things are very different. Our fundamental rights and human rights are much more, you know, stronger and efficient as compared to China. All right. Although we do have a directive principle of state policy in the Constitution of India, which does direct the government that they have to take measures to control the population of India, and the government might come up with a new law wherein they can have such a policy. All right, but China mein koi usko Supreme Court leke nahi jata hai, koi us policy or law pe ladai nahi karta hai. In India, what will happen? The moment such a law comes, it will be taken directly to the Supreme Court of India to be judged that is it constitutional or not. Okay, so such thing, such democracy in India exists. That is why we are not able to, that is why we don't have such laws. Ma'am, it can be said that in some fronts, communist governments are better than democracy. See, this is a debate that can go on for days. Every system has its pros and cons. So I'll just leave it at that. Yes. There are certain ways in which communism will be better. There are certain ways in which democracy is better. All right. So yes, all systems will have their pros and cons. And, you know, it's our human nature. Grass will always be greener on other side. वहाँ कोई labor laws नहीं है, कोई human rights नहीं है, कोई तुम्हारे पास judicial powers नहीं है. In India, see, so many people are filing cases. CA was passed, Citizenship Amendment Act was passed. How many people filed their cases against CA? Can you do that in China? No, you most certainly cannot. All right, so such things are not available there. In some aspects, yes, it might be better. Ab wahan pe agar labor rights nahi hai, to wahan ki economy dekho kaise grow kar rahi hai. Chinese samaan sasta aata hai kyunki labor ke koi rights hi nahi hai na. Tum 10-10 ghante kaam karwao. All right. So yes, these are the factors that do affect. Now next we come to the growth in population. So growth can be both ways. It can be a positive growth or it can be a negative growth. हाँ जी, इंडिया क्या देख रहा है, पॉजिटिव और नेगेटिव? इंडिया में कैसी ग्रोथ दिख रही है तुमको? अरे पॉजिटिव ही है, पॉजिटिव. हाउ इज इट नेगेटिव? नंबर ऑफ पीपल आर इंक्रीजिंग, नो? हाउ इज इट नेगेटिव ग्रोथ? पॉजिटिव मींस नंबर ऑफ पीपल आर राइजिंग, नेगेटिव वुड मीन नंबर ऑफ पीपल आर डिक्रीजिंग. सो इट्स अ पॉजिटिव ग्रोथ. All right. So population growth क्या है कि आप आज देखो क्या population है, then you set a frame of time कि एक साल बाद कितनी होगी, दो साल बाद कितनी होगी, and then you count. So between two points of time, what is the change in the population? Has it increased? Then it's a positive growth. Has it decreased? Then it is a negative growth. All right. Understood? So in India, yes, we have been seeing positive growth, and population growth has two components. All right, natural growth and induced growth. हाँ भाई, क्या होगा तुम्हारे हिसाब से इनका मतलब, natural growth and induced growth? You give me your answers. I'll just have a glass of water. Till then, you type your answers. What do you understand by natural growth of population and induced growth of population? क्या लगता है तुमको, क्या मतलब होगा इन दोनों स्टेटमेंट का? Natural includes without government direction. Natural includes immigration. थोड़ा सोचो, अगर मैं तुमको बोलूं एक एरिया की पॉपुलेशन नेचुरली ग्रो कर रही है तो तुम्हारे दिमाग में पहली चीज क्या आएगी? What will be the first thing that comes to your mind when I say इस एरिया की जो पॉपुलेशन है that's growing naturally? Yes, the birth rate and death rate. So natural growth in population is analyzed by assessing the birth rate and death rate. एक साल में एक टाइम पे कितने बच्चे पैदा हो रहे हैं और कितने लोगों की डेथ हो रही है. All right. So let's say if in a region 1,000 new children are born in 1 year, all right, and 500 people are dying, so natural growth will be plus 500 people. All right, whereas induced growth will be, it will be migration. How many people are coming in that region and how many people are moving out of that region. So it basically means there are going to be two things, immigration and emigration. Immigration and emigration. Immigration, how many people move into a country? That is
move into a country or a region, that is immigration. Emigration, how many people move out of that region, that is emigration. So suppose I am from Punjab, I am coming and working in Bombay. So I am an immigrant in Mumbai and emigrant from Punjab. Okay? Understood? All right. So now this chapter particularly deals with natural growth of India's population. All right. And we discuss the decadal as well as the annual growth rates of population in India. All right. So now they are both very high in India and obviously they are increasing also with time. All right. So what is decadal growth rate? What do you understand by decadal growth rate? Which population theory do we follow in India? Okay, for that, you first tell me what are the various population theories. Pre-Malthusian, Malthusian, socialist and classical. Rather than going into that detail, I would say that one is Malthusian theory. Malthusian theory basically says that agar population badhti jayegi, to khane ki kami ho jayegi. Aur khane ki jab kami hogi, to obviously logon ki death hone lag jayegi. But this theory is rejected. All right. This theory is rejected. There are many drawbacks to this theory. कि सिर्फ खाना थोड़ी चाहिए होता है इंसान को. All right. Then the second theory that we study is known as the optimum theory of population, which links population growth with economy. So this is a little more realistic. All right, as compared to the Malthusian theory. All right. Then you have theory of demographic transition, and this is the one that we follow in India. All right. There are three different stages of population growth, and that is the one that we follow in India. And having said that, you do not need that much of detail in geography about population distribution theories until and unless your optional subject is either economics or geography. All right. You do not need this much detail. Unless if your optional is geography or economics, then you will need this. But other than that, it won't be required. The very basics of human geography, which are given in NCERT, are more than sufficient. All right. That is why for human geography, we do not follow any other book other than NCERT. For the people who are just doing it for the GS and prelims basis, yes. Those of you who are doing it for your optional, you will most certainly need other books. All right. So in India, we follow the last one, the demographic transition theory. In fact, all across the world, we tend to follow that. In fact, in your NCRTs also, demographic transition theory is explained, which of course we'll come to in some time. All right. All right. So in India, natural population growth is very high. All right. Ye to tumko pata hai, fertility rate bahut zyada hai. Now, every time in India, you know, in all across the world, demographic transition hota hai, or you know, there is a change in the growth of population. All right. So all across the world, there are three phases wherein the population grows. Okay. In the first phase, you imagine pre-independence India or pre-British India also. All right. What was happening? No method of birth control. No medical facilities. All right. No vaccination. All right. No good hospitals. So what was happening? बर्थ कंट्रोल नहीं है, लिटरेसी नहीं है, कुछ नहीं है, तो बहुत सारे बच्चे पैदा हो रहे हैं. बर्थ रेट इज वेरी हाई, बट एट द सेम टाइम मेडिकल फैसिलिटीज भी अच्छे नहीं है. एक बार कॉलरा हुआ, पूरा का पूरे गांव खत्म. सो डेथ रेट इज ऑल्सो वेरी हाई. सो द फर्स्ट फेज इज हाई बर्थ रेट एंड हाई डेथ रेट. ऑल राइट. First phase is high birth rate and high death rate. So population growth kya hoga? Ya to nahi hoga, ya bahut kam hoga, stable rahegi population. Understood? Now come to the second phase. That is India just after independence. Okay. Matlab I'm just giving you broad examples. तो क्या हुआ, एकदम से गवर्नमेंट स्टार्टेड टेकिंग मेजर्स कि लोगों की हेल्थ खराब है, हम हॉस्पिटल्स बनाएंगे, बट लिटरेसी ज्यादा नहीं है, बेटर फैसिलिटीज मिल रही है तुमको डिलीवरी के लिए, तो बच्चे की डेथ होना एकदम से डिलीवरी के बाद या मदर की डेथ हो जाना डिलीवरी के समय, वो चीजें कम हो गई. एज इट इज वैक्सीनेशन इंप्रूव हुआ, मेडिकल फैसिलिटीज इंप्रूव हुई, तो डेथ रेट भी कम हो गया. सो व्हाट हैपेंड दैट द बर्थ रेट इंक्रीज्ड because of good medical facilities and the death rate decreased because of good medical facilities. So this is the time period of the second phase, is the growth of population phase. This is the time when you will have the maximum growth in population, and this is the time that India is in right now. All right. So second phase, this is the theory of demographic transition. Second phase is the growth of population phase. Now third phase, you imagine a country like US. Well-educated people, they understand that they can't have more than a certain number of children. It will be difficult. Plus the medical facilities are good. Literacy is there. People understand governance and policies are good. So the birth rate is less. And good medical facilities, so the death rate is also there. So again, you come to a very stable kind of a very or very slow moving population, or in certain countries, even a negative population growth. All right. So these are the three phases of demographic transition that any country or any region in the world goes through. All right. Now in India, we divide the whole thing into four phases. Okay. First is from 1901 to 1921. Then you have from 1921 to 51, then from 51 to 81, right? And then from 81 to present. All right. Now you tell me what will be there from 1901 to 21 based on what I have just told you. 1901 to 21 ke beech mein aapko kya milega, batao. I just told you the three stages. Correct. High birth rate as well as low, high death rate. All right. In fact, there was a time in the year 1911 to 1921 when we also showed a negative growth rate. Because at that time, what happened? even you know when the British were here in India, अगर famine हो गया, drought हो गया, तो वो थोड़ी ना ध्यान देते थे कि लोग भूखे मर रहे हैं. Even those conditions were seen. So either you had a stagnant growth or like I said, in 10 years we also had a negative growth. So इसके लिए reasons क्या थे? Poor health, poor medical facilities, illiteracy of the people, inefficient food distribution system. कोई food distribution system आपका अच्छा नहीं था. जैसे आज है ना public distribution system, वो उस time पे नहीं था. All right. तो अगर famine आ गया या drought पड़ गया तो British were not interested. तुम जी रहे हो या मर रहे हो. Why would they care? They are getting their raw material that they want to supply to London. So no problem. All right. So we had a very high birth rate and a very high death rate during this period. Now you tell me, what do you think happened during the period of 1921 to 51? 1921 to 51. Why the census was done? See, because of the pressure of certain Indians, all right, who were interested and who said that we need to do this and we need to understand what the population composition is. All right. So there were certain enlightened individuals who pressurized the government enough for census. All right. Plus, इसमें ब्रिटिश का भी थोड़ा फायदा था. They would know which regions have higher population. They would know which region have higher labor force. Which region is educated from where they can extract human resources that they need. All right. Now you tell me from 1921 to 51. Okay, Zahra says it's same. It's a period of high growth. Stagnant population. See, this was a period of steady population growth. राइट सो सी दिस इज 21 to 51. एक तो इस टाइम पे हम ब्रिटिश गवर्नमेंट को जो था बहुत ज्यादा प्रेशराइज कर चुके थे. एंड ब्रिटिश गवर्नमेंट ने क्या किया था, आफ्टर सर्टन रिफॉर्म्स दे गेव दिस थिंग यू नो पब्लिक हेल्थ एजुकेशन इन द हैंड्स ऑफ इंडियंस हु वर इन द गवर्नमेंट. ऑल राइट सो दे गेव इट टू द इंडियंस हु वर इन द ब्रिटिश गवर्नमेंट. तुमको पता है बहुत सारे इंडियंस ने भी सीट्स के लिए लड़ा था इलेक्शंस. सो दैट इज व्हाई नाउ सी फॉर ब्रिटिश इट वाज अ पेटी इशू. ऑलराइट सो दीज इंडियंस हु वर अ पार्ट ऑफ नाउ द ब्रिटिश गवर्नमेंट दे स्टार्टेड टू फोकस ऑन हेल्थ फैसिलिटीज. एंड देन पोस्ट 1947 यस अ लॉट ऑफ चेंजेस टुक प्लेस एंड एट दिस टाइम the crude birth rate remained very high and that is why it led to a higher growth rate as compared to the previous phase. All right, as compared to the previous phase, as compared to the period of 1911 to 1921. And you know, at that time British government, abhi kaise har MP ya har MLA ko you give a certain amount that you know you need to do development in this area. All right, so you are given a certain amount of money. So at that time, the British, they did not give much money na, to Indians. So at that time, our Indian politicians were so nice that they used to cut their own salaries. They used to reduce their own salaries and put that money for developmental works. All right. You have to focus, Shubham. You really can't be overcome with anger. This is a part of history that you have to learn. All right, and you have to ensure your emotional stability. One of the greatest qualities that almost all successful civil servants will have is a lot of emotional stability. Because you can't just take decisions out of anger or out of sadness or out of any other emotion. All right, so you need to have a lot of emotional stability. Now next comes the period of 1951 to 81, and this is the period of population explosion in India. पॉपुलेशन एक्सप्लोजन इसलिए हुआ क्योंकि हमारा जो डेथ रेट था वो बहुत ज्यादा, मोर्टैलिटी रेट जो था वो बहुत ज्यादा कम हो गया, वेयर एज द फर्टिलिटी रेट इन द पॉपुलेशन इट इंक्रीज्ड वेरी मच. रीजन वॉज द सेम, मेडिकल फैसिलिटीज बहुत अच्छे हो गए, राइट? एंड दैट इज वेन इंडिया सॉ वॉट इज नोन एज पॉपुलेशन एक्सप्लोजन. ऑल राइट, यहाँ पे तुमको स्टेडी ग्रोथ दिख रहा था कि थोड़े थोड़े करके लोग बढ़ रहे हैं. हियर यू हैव अ वेरी हाई ग्रोथ रेट एज मच एज 2.2%. ऑल राइट, एनुअल ग्रोथ रेट वॉज 2.2%. देन फ्रॉम द लास्ट फेज विच इज फ्रॉम 1981 टिल प्रेजेंट. ऑल राइट, सो इंडियाज पॉपुलेशन ग्रोथ रेट it has remained high and in fact it has started slowing down also, but as such the growth is positive. Abhi bhi log add hi ho rahe, kam nahi ho rahe, na hi stable hai, right? Yes, but as such the growth, the rate of growth has decreased in India. All right, but we know that it is still very high in the country, and the World Development Report, it states that India will touch 101,350,000 by 2025. All right. Who publishes the World Development Report? Who publishes the World Development Report? It is published by the World Bank. All right. So in UPSC, अगर तुम देखोगे previous year papers, तो हर बार एक आधा सवाल ऐसा जरूर आता है, wherein they ask you about reports and who publishes those reports. Okay. So these kind of questions are important for your prelims. Okay. Reports who are they published by? या हर साल की report में अगर कुछ बहुत important आया है तो देन यू हैव टू सी. बट इट्स नॉट रिलेटेड टू बैंक. आई डोंट अंडरस्टैंड योर क्वेश्चन. ओह, यू मीन द डेवलपमेंट रिपोर्ट एंड द पॉपुलेशन इज नॉट रिलेटेड टू अ बैंक. सी, द वर्ल्ड डेवलपमेंट रिपोर्ट डज नॉट सी ओनली पॉपुलेशन, इट सीज अदर फैक्टर्स ऑल्सो, इकोनॉमिक डेवलपमेंट एंड दोज थिंग्स. ऑलराइट, that is most certainly related to the banking system. So just like, you know, how we see that there is a variation in India as when it comes to population density or population distribution, all right, so just like that there is also a variation when it comes to population growth. So you know that certain states, which obviously, which the ones which have a high population and a high density and low literacy, they will show high population growth, whereas others will show the lowest population growth. For example, Kerala has registered the lowest population growth. All right, so it varies because of the similar reasons that we have studied. All right, so do you understand this part? Do you understand this much? Do I need to explain the reasons again for population growth variation? It's the same reasons. Do I need to explain them again? Others? See, you know, all across the world, we say that agar ek time tak tumne apni population ka fayda nahi uthaya, right, then what will happen? That you will not be able to grow at a later stage. So this is the time when we are going to grow as a country. Why do we say that? Because this is the time when we have a young population or a youthful population. All right. So one of the aspects of population growth is the growth of adolescents. All right. So adolescent population means youthful population. They have high potential, right? But at the same time, you have to ensure that, you know, you channelize their energy properly. One of the same adolescent will go into drugs and all also. Okay. And then they will become a liability rather than an asset. Okay. So that is why they say that if you don't grow and if you don't take advantage of this young phase of your population, then later you will not be able to grow. Your growth rate will become stagnant. Okay. Who developed this theory? You mean the theory of demographic transition? It was given by Warren Thompson. It was given by Warren Thompson. WARRENTHOMPSON. Warren Thompson. All right. So with this youthful population, you have to be very careful. You have to ensure that there is no child marriage. There is no illiteracy. There is no use of drugs. There is no adolescent pregnancies. There is no risk of sexually transmitted diseases. There is no juvenile delinquency. There is no committance of crime. So these things are what you have to be careful with. And yes, this is the time when you can grow in your economic development and for the nation. All right. So that is why we have a lot of policies for this particular adolescent group. For example, we have the National Youth Policy. All right. Similarly, you have so many other schemes. Crude birth rate. Crude birth rate is very basic. How many people are born per 1,000 people? Okay, that is known as crude birth rate. Ek saal mein kitne bachche paida hue, usko bolte hai crude birth rate. Right. Now, there are other things also. What is the infant mortality rate? Ye sab cheezon ko jab hum nahi count karte, and we just count the crude birth rate. Kitne live births ho rahe. That is basic. That is crude birth rate. All right. Okay, so you had the National Youth Policy, which was launched in the year 2003. It does a lot for the youth, right? It gives them education, it gives them vocational training. All right, so these things, if you are getting into education, they'll try to reinforce the qualities of patriotism. They'll try to make you a responsible citizen. They'll try to keep you away from those things like sexually transmitted diseases or alcoholism or committing crimes. Right. So such policies are there so that we can have youth wherein, you know, who work as an asset for the nation. All right. Now, this is not just one program. We have many schemes for the youth in India. All right. Batao bhai, kisi ko pata hai koi schemes jo youth ke liye chal rahi ho India mein? Hai koi mission? Startup India, Make in India, Skill India, Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao, Fit India Movement. Fit India Movement to pata hoga na, abhi abhi shuru hui hai. Fit India Movement. Right, so these are the examples. These are just few examples. Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan, correct. Halo India. So these are the various movements that we have for our youth. All right, because we know they are our asset, and we know that agar humne ab is asset ka fayda nahi uthaya to hum aage bhi nahi utha payenge. All right. Okay. Now, next topic that we have is population composition. See, jab hum population composition ki baat karte hain, to there are various aspects of population composition. All right, there are many aspects of population composition. Jaise kitni percent population male hai, kitni percent population female hai, kitni percent population rural area mein rehti hai, kitni percent population urban area mein rehti hai, kitni percent population illiterate hai, kitni percent population literate hai. Right? Kitni percent population is from religious majorities and kitni percent population is from religious minorities. So all of that is a part of what we call as population composition. All right. So population composition will analyze a lot of things like age. How many people in the economy are above 60? How many are below 60? How many are between 15 to 60, jisko hum working population mante hain? How many are below 15 and above 60 who are dependent, right? So what is the age? What is the sex? What is the place of residence? What is the ethnic characteristic? What is the tribal percentage in a population? Religion, kitni percent population married hai, kitni unmarried hai? Literacy, how much are employed or unemployed, right? How much are literate or illiterate? All of that is a factor within population composition. Okay, so these are the various factors of population composition. Raj, I'll take your doubt in a minute. Let me just finish this one topic and then I'll take your doubt. All right. So India mein bhi hum bahut aspects study karte hain population composition ke, like we study the rural, urban, language, religion. All right, those things. Okay. Now your doubt is about the 2021 census and caste issue. What is this issue? Ye batao pehle to. What is this issue? 2021 will consider caste while counting. Why is it so? Okay. So the census in 2021, it is unlikely to collect caste-wise data. All right. The official reason that is given is that because to the government, all right, and it will become very difficult to tabulate and collect information for every such caste. All right, and they say that if they start collecting, one other reason that was given during March was that if they start collecting such caste-based data, it will give rise to the fear that, you know, more people will start demanding reservation and it will affect the secular nature of the state. All right. So this was another reason that was given. Okay. So these are the reasons that are given by the government. Understood? And yes, there are apprehensions against it also. Okay, a lot of people have apprehensions against it that you need to have caste-based data so that we can have schemes for those particular castes. All right. So the first factor that we consider is the rural-urban composition. How many percentage of people are living in the rural areas and how many are living in urban areas? Hanji, bataiye, where do you think majority of Indian population stays, rural or urban areas, according to the 2011 census? Yes, majority of our population stays in the villages. According to the 2011 census, 68.8% of the total population lives in villages because majority of our population is employed in the primary sector of agriculture. That is why they live in the villages. All right. Either agriculture or mining, they're all employed in primary sector. So that is why they live in rural areas. All right. Then obviously state wise also things vary a lot. For example, that you have states like Bihar, Sikkim, where rural population is very high, whereas states like Goa and Maharashtra, the rural population is comparatively lower. Reason being ke in cities mein urban hubs, in states mein urban hubs bahut zyada hain. Ab tum, you go to Arunachal Pradesh, urban area hai hi kitne. right? Barely any urban areas. So obviously, whatever is the population living, they're going to live in rural areas only, no? If there are no urban areas, then where will you live? All right. So the same thing follows for this thing. Bigger states like Goa and Maharashtra, yahan pe urban areas zyada hai, so obviously people are living in urban areas. People in urban areas are comparatively higher as compared to other states. All right, now you come to union territories. Now union territory of Delhi, how will you have rural population there? The whole area is urban. Chandigarh, how will you have rural population? Okay, so other than Dadra and Nagar Haveli, they have very small, other union territories have very small rural population. All right. Now, there are many people who migrate from rural areas to urban areas. So you have rural to rural migration, rural to urban migration. So these kind of migrations take place within a state or also outside the state. Okay. Then next you have linguistic composition. All right. So in India, there are 22 official scheduled languages. By scheduled languages, we mean the languages which are a part of the Constitution of India, Schedule 8. All right. So after the whole Constitution of India is written, uske baad list di hai bahut sari. To wo list ko bolte hai schedule. So one of the lists, that is Schedule 8, it tells you about the official languages of the state, that is official languages of India. So there are 22 scheduled languages and there are many, many non-scheduled languages of India. All right. So if you want to see that how many languages, like I do this exercise in class physically, that you take out a 10 rupee note or a 100 rupee note and you can start counting that how many languages are there on that note. All right. So you want to do that exercise right now? Take out a 10 rupee note or a 100 rupee note. And then you tell me how many languages are there on that note. Take out a note. Hoge na sab log ghar pe hi ho, ek note le lo koi bhi. 10, 20, whatever. 10, get a 10 rupee note. Sabke paas hoga. Nahi hai to 100 ka le lo. Koi dikkat nahi hai. And you tell me how many languages are there. 10 languages. No. There are a total of 17 languages. Hindi or English ko chhod ke 17 languages aur hoti hain jisme ek note pe currency likhi hoti hai, and in the recent notes you find it in Braille also. So other than Hindi and English, you have it in Assamese, Bengali, Gujarati, Kannada, Kashmiri, Konkani, Malayalam, Marathi, Nepali, Odia, Punjabi, Sanskrit, Tamil, Telugu and Urdu. The reason why I remember it in this order is because on the note it is written in alphabetical order. So jab note ke side pe dekhoge to sabse pehle Assamese hogi, fir Bengali hogi, fir Gujarati hogi, Kannada, Kashmiri, Konkani, Malayalam, Marathi, Nepali, Odia, Punjabi, Sanskrit, Tamil, Telugu, Urdu. So that is why I remember it in a sequence, because it is written in the sequence on the note. And other than these languages, Hindi, English mein to hota hai note ke upar likha ho. All right. So you can imagine that yes, India has a large linguistic diversity also. So we, in every census, we see how many people are Hindi speaking, how many people are Marathi speaking or Urdu speaking, and we calculate their numbers, right? So for, by far, we have people, majority of people in India, they are Hindi speaking. So aisa kya hota hai? When we say Hindi speaking people, we also include the various dialects of Hindi. All right. सिर्फ हिंदी नहीं लेते, हिंदी के जो बहुत सारे डायलेक्ट्स होते हैं उसको भी साथ में इंक्लूड कर लेते हैं. नाउ यू नो द स्मॉलेस्ट ग्रुप्स आर कश्मीरी स्पीकिंग एंड संस्कृत स्पीकिंग. संस्कृत स्पीकिंग पीपल एंड कश्मीरी स्पीकिंग पीपल आर वेरी फ्यू. All right. Then there are certain languages जो पहले थी इंडिया में अब नहीं है, right? So these are known as extinct languages, जो इनको अब कोई बोलने वाला नहीं रह गया, right? For example, Ahom, Andro, right? Singmai. These are extinct languages. Okay. All right, so they are known as extinct languages, जिनको अब कोई बोलने वाला नहीं रह गया है. Nobody speaks these languages anymore. All right. Next, after linguistic composition, linguistic classification. So in India, you know, we have linguistic classification. So for example, first you have Austric family, then you have Dravidian family, then you have Sino-Tibetan family, then you have Indo-European family. So Austric family basically means the languages which are spoken in the region of Northeast ya Andaman Nicobar wali belt mein ya Eastern India mein jo boli jati hai, right? Dravidian, which is mostly South India or Central India. So your Telugu, Tamil, they're all Dravidian languages. Sino-Tibetan languages, which are spoken in Sino-Tibetan. So Chinese and Tibet wala jo region hai, upper Himalayas mein jo boli jati hai, J&K, Himachal, Sikkim, Arunachal Pradesh, those are Sino-Tibetan language. Right, then you have Indo-European languages, jahan jinko tum Indo-Aryan languages bolte ho, inki percentage sabse zyada hai. So this is the language, even your Hindi, Sanskrit, they all come from this part, all right? So Rajasthan, UP, these are Indo-Aryan languages, okay? Then you have religious composition in India. So we calculate how many percentage of people are from which community. So there are many religions in India, Hindus being the majority. Then you have Muslims, Christians, Sikhs, Buddhists, Jains, others. Others mein aur kaun kaun aayega batao zara. Zoroastrians हो गए, Jews हो गए, कुछ हो गए, थोड़े बहुत Jews वैसे बहुत कम है इंडिया में. All right. So these come under others. All right. Okay. Next is the composition of working population. How many people are employed? How many people are unemployed in India? All right. So in India, we divide working population into three groups. Main workers, marginal workers, and non-workers. Okay. Now, what do you think is the difference between a main worker and a marginal worker? What is the difference between a main worker and a marginal worker? I don't want the definition from you. I don't expect it. But yes, कुछ तुम्हें आइडिया लगता हो कि बेसिक हाँ ये फर्क होना चाहिए दोनों में. Correct. The difference is the time period of employability. जो main worker है वो ज्यादा देर के लिए एम्प्लॉयड रहता है, जो मार्जिनल वर्कर है वो कम समय के लिए एम्प्लॉयड रहता है. और व्हाट इज द डिफरेंस अकॉर्डिंग टू द सेंसस डेफिनेशन, मेन वर्कर इज अ पर्सन हु इज एम्प्लॉयड फॉर एटलीस्ट सिक्स मंथ्स इन अ ईयर, एंड अ पर्सन हु इज एम्प्लॉयड फॉर लेस देन सिक्स मंथ्स इन अ ईयर, ही इज नोन एज अ मार्जिनल वर्कर. ऑलराइट, सो इन इंडिया अकॉर्डिंग टू द 2011 सेंसस, the number of non-workers, that means the number of unemployed people, they are higher as compared to the number of, मतलब total number of marginal plus main workers. तो जितने लोग marginally या main workers जो employed है, right? उनको अगर तुम add कर लो, उन दोनों का total भी अगर ले लो, so that is less than the number of unemployed people in India according to the 2011 population census. All right. Then again, the numbers vary from state to state. All right. So why do you think this happens? Why do we have higher number of unemployed people? Yes, Manrega will be marginal. Correct. Why do you think we will have less number of higher number of unemployed population? Also Rajshree, it will depend. काफी लोग हैं जो मनरेगा में भी काम करते हैं और उसके अलावा भी काम करते हैं. So जो सिर्फ मनरेगा में होंगे, they will be marginal, but there are others who are employed in multiple jobs, so they can be non-marginal also. They can be male workers. Why do you think that we have a higher population of unemployed people in India? Low employment opportunities are a result of what? It's mostly due to lack of economic development in the country. All right. So a higher number of unemployed population, it indicates a lack economic status wherein mostly population is dependent, and it shows lack of economic development. All right. Further, number of people employed and unemployed, they vary from state to state. Certain states have higher employment aspect, opportunities. So their people are more, right? Ab kya hai? Jaise there are certain people who have migrated. All right. Now there is a person who is from, let's say, Bihar. Okay. So he migrates to Mumbai for a job because Bihar mein nahi mil raha usko job opportunity. So he has moved to Mumbai. I take the example of Bihar because Bihar, UP, Odisha, yahan se maximum migration hoti hai. Not because I'm trying to say that some state is bad or some state is good. All right. So they move from Bihar to UP. Why? Because population the employment opportunities are less in a certain state and higher in another state. All right. So that is why you will find employment opportunities. ये हर स्टेट में वेरी करते हैं डिपेंडिंग ऑन द गवर्नमेंट पॉलिसीज डिपेंडिंग ऑन अर्बनाइजेशन डिपेंडिंग ऑन इंडस्ट्रियलाइजेशन डिपेंडिंग ऑन द अवेलेबिलिटी ऑफ नेचुरल रिसोर्सेज ऑलराइट सो सिंस दीस फैक्टर्स दे वेरी सो दैट इज व्हाई पॉपुलेशन ऑफ कंपोजिशन ऑफ पॉपुलेशन विद रिस्पेक्ट टू एम्प्लॉयमेंट वेरीज फ्रॉम स्टेट टू स्टेट ऑलराइट सो इन इंडिया वी डिवाइड The 2001 census, it divided the working categories into four categories: cultivators, agricultural laborers, household and industrial workers, and other workers. All right, so this is how it was divided. All right, now when it comes to gender-based distribution, then you know that female workers are higher in primary sector. All right, why? Because women ko tum इंडिया का तो क्या है बेटी को तो पढ़ाना ही नहीं है तो अगर तुम नहीं पढ़ाओगे तो लड़की क्या काम करेगी ऑलराइट इफ यू डोंट कल्टीवेटर्स एंड एग्रीकल्चरल लेबरर्स कल्टीवेटर विल ओन द लैंड एग्रीकल्चरल लेबर विल नॉट ओन द लैंड ओके सो वुमेन विल बी हायर इन प्राइमरी सेक्टर क्यों बीस्ट ऑफ बर्डन है काम ज्यादा कर सकती है प्लस पढ़ाते नहीं हो तो वो ऑब्वियसली वही काम करेगी ना She will not be able to become a doctor. No, if you don't teach her, she can't start practicing medicine. All right. Plus, unpaid primary sector work bhi female se bahut liya jata hai. Ki waise kuch kaam nahi kar rahi hai, but kheton mein apne ghar ke khet mein kaam kar rahi hai. Apne ghar ke bartan dho rahi hai, apne ghar ki safai kar rahi hai. So, unpaid work bhi bahut liya ja raha hai. So, number of female workers as compared to any other sector is higher in primary sector. उसमें भी एग्रीकल्चर सेक्टर इज द वन विच एम्प्लॉयज मैक्सिमम लेबर इन इंडिया ओके ओके सो दिस इज अबाउट द पॉपुलेशन डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन विद रिस्पेक्ट टू वर्किंग पॉपुलेशन इन इंडिया ऑलराइट देन यू हैव जेंडर बेस्ड पॉपुलेशन ऑल्सो इन इंडिया देर आर सर्टन स्टेट्स जहां पे जेंडर रेशियो इज गुड देर आर सर्टन वेयर इट इज बैड So now you tell me which is the state which has the lowest sex ratio in India. Sex ratio is number of females per 1,000 males. It can also be number of males per 1,000 females, but in India it is calculated as number as females per 1,000 males. What according to the 2011 census, which is the state with lowest sex ratio? Correct. When it came to states, it was the state of Haryana which had the lowest sex ratio. All right. Plus, there when it comes to the union territories, it was the union territory of Daman and Diu which showed the lowest sex ratios. The highest sex ratio was seen in the state of Kerala, the only state which had more females as compared to males. So there were 1.084 females per 1,000 males in the state of Kerala. All right. Now, Rajshree has a question, natural versus induced growth. So you tell me which will be the states wherein you will see a high induced growth. Migration kaun se states mein zyada hogi? Ye bataiye mujhe. It will be the developed states, right? Gujarat, Punjab, Maharashtra. You will have more induced growth here. Higher birth, natural growth kahan pe hogi? States like UP, Bihar, there you will have a higher natural growth. All right. So these are the various factors that we consider while calculating gender composition or population composition. Understood? Is everything clear in this chapter? There is a new student, Adil Ghani. Do you understand? Because you've not responded in the entire class. Adil, do you understand? All right. Who are the other new students? How will you use this static with current affairs, ma'am? You mean this, what I've taught today, or you're asking in general? So what I've taught today, see, today you've learned a lot of concepts. Like I said, 2011 census se sawal aana bahut mushkil hai. But if you are planning to give your exam later, this current affairs with respect to census, who conducts the census, what was the result of the census, all of this will become very important. Plus, if you get any latest data, kisi state ka koi data nikalta hai, literacy pe, education pe, so you have to study this. Ma'am, for GS, do we have to study sociology and anthropology? No, not needed. Other than what is given in the basic NCRT, is nothing needed. What is the clear difference between density and distribution? Distribution ka matlab hai ki population kitni hai, number of people. 100 log hai, 150 log hai, 200 log hai. Density ka matlab hai, 1 km² mein kitne log hai. All right, that is the clear difference between the two. Per area, agar aap dekhoge, to that is density. If you just look at number, that is distribution. Okay? Anybody else? Any other doubts? I hope ke samajh mein aa gaya hoga sabko kuch kuch. If not sab kuch, kuch kuch to samajh aa gaya hoga. All right. So there you all have been given a schedule which you have to follow. So yeah, tomorrow we'll start the second chapter. So you have to follow that schedule. You have to read that chapter, solve the MCQs, and then solve the subjective question. All right. Send the subjective questions, photograph through a mail or whatever the institute has told you. We will evaluate the answer and give you the evaluated copy. All right. प्लीज इंश्योर कि तुम आंसर लिखो ऐसे मत लिखना आंसर की एक वर्ड लिमिट होती है मेक श्योर दैट यू ट्राई टू स्टिक टू इट बिकॉज इवन इफ यू डोंट स्टिक टू दैट वर्ड लिमिट यू विल नेवर बी एबल टू कंप्लीट योर मेन्स पेपर ऑलराइट सो डोंट ट्राई टू राइट आंसर्स लाइक यू राइट इन कॉलेज वेर इन यू ट्राई टू फिल द एक्स नंबर ऑफ शीट्स और वाई नंबर ऑफ शीट्स All right. Haryana has improved the ratio, so which data should we follow? See, that is why whenever I ask the questions in the in today's lecture, I always mention 2011 census. All right. You should try to follow the latest data, but make sure that that data comes from a government source. Okay. That is important. All right. In how much time should we try to finish one answer? Ideally, in the exam, you get 7 to 8 minutes to write one answer. But since you're just beginning, I'll say 10 to 15 minutes. But later, yes, with time, it should be 7 to 8 minutes. All right. So make sure that you attempt those MCQs and the subjective questions. Mostly, we have given MCQs like they're, you know, comprehension from the chapter. So they'll help you in understanding. They'll help you in understanding how well you have grasped the chapter. All right. Then we'll meet tomorrow now, 3 to 5. Okay. All right, bye-bye, take care.